Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. And the first portfolio is wellbeing, economy, fair work and energy. I again would make a plea for succinct questions and answers in order to allow as many members to get in as possible. Question number one, not lodged. Question number two, Craig Coy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on which rules and incentives are central to a wellbeing economy.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we transition to a wellbeing economy, we will maximise powers currently available to us to grow a fairer, greener economy, seizing the opportunities of net zero, creating better communities, tackling poverty and embedding equality, inclusion and human rights in everything we do. Our National Strategy for Economic Transformation and Energy Strategy, including our approach to fair working conditionality, set out many of the actions and investments we are taking forward to deliver this vision, and will continue to make it the case that with independence we can do much more to realise our vision for a wellbeing economy.
Craig Coy.
I thank the Minister for that answer. A thriving local high street is vital to the wellbeing of communities and the economies in towns such as Dunbar, Haddington, Pennycook, Melrose and right across the south of Scotland region. So can the Minister explain in what way the decision to impose the disastrous deposit return scheme on cafes, pubs and restaurants is in any way sensible rulemaking? And how can this Government's abject failure to pass on the 75% business rates relief to Scotland's hospitality and retail operators ever be viewed as an incentive for them to grow and invest in a wellbeing economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. So, first of all, the hospitality and tourism industries are represented on the New Deal for Business Group that I co-chaired along with Dr. Poonam Malik last week, and we're taking representations both on the non-domestic rates situation. Obviously, we have a very generous non-domestic rates offering and the most generous small business bonus scheme anywhere in the UK, which helps to support our high streets. And in terms of the deposit return scheme, obviously we are looking to ensure that we develop a circular economy. That is important for our net zero journey, but also it's an economic opportunity if we can get recycling right. We have a huge commodity in Scotland, and making sure that we harness that and take it forward well is what one of the central aims of the deposit return scheme.
Question number three, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is giving to bring people with children back into work.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Parental employment support seeks to increase parental income from employment. Our eligibility recognises different family structures, such as kinship care, or those who are parents but not living with their children. Responding to the fact that more than two-thirds of children in poverty live in working households, we broadened eligibility to ensure parents in low-income employment can access person-centred support to help them increase their income. We work with local partners, promoting employment as a route out of poverty and attracting parents to the support available, ensuring employment opportunities are fair and flexible to family circumstances.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary's answer regarding local partners. Can I ask if the Cabinet Secretary has discussions or engagement with private and public sector employers regarding utilising home working and separately provision, where practicable, especially of the 1140 hours free nursery care, and if it can be utilised by them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes. While the legal powers governing flexible working are reserved to the UK Government, we remain committed to improving access to flexible working for all sectors of the economy. We welcome the progress of the Employment Relations Bill through the UK Parliament, but feel it does not go far enough in giving all employees and therefore employers confidence that requests for flexible working will be given thorough consideration. Asking employers to offer flexible working from day one of employment has already been a requirement of our Fair Work First criteria on public spend since October 2021, and since August 2021 all councils have been offering 1140 hours of funded early learning and childcare to all eligible children, and the most recent ELC census shows that over 92,500 children were accessing funded ELC across Scotland in 2022, and the estimated uptake rate of funded ELC for 3- and 4-year-olds is 99% in 2022. So we'll continue to work closely with local government to embed the benefits of expansion as more families come forward, ensuring that childcare is flexible, affordable, accessible and high quality.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Private and voluntary nurseries are often able to offer a greater degree of flexibility of childcare hours than local authorities, something that's especially important for shift workers like nurses. But the funding model undermines their ability to retain experienced staff in the sector, especially during amid a cost of living crisis and increasing pay levels. So when will we see a change to help those children who wish to help those with children who wish to return to work?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Beatrice Wishart for that question. I've received representation from the PVI sector. I know Natalie Dawn has met with representatives of the PVI sector to discuss just those issues that Beatrice Wishart raises. I'm hoping to meet with PVI representatives soon as well so that we can cement the fact that a strong childcare provision is central to our economic aspirations, and I'll look to provide an update as soon as I can.
Question number four, Mercedes Viaba.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Energy Minister has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the recommendations to the Scottish Government contained in the report Our Power, Offshore Workers' Demands for a Just Energy Transition.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government welcomes the report and agrees that listening to and acting on recommendations from offshore workers is critical to ensure a just transition. That's why we've provided £100,000 in funding to the STUC to ensure workers' voices are at the very heart of our just transition planning. And my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Just Transition and Net Zero, has been advised that the recommendations provided within this report will be considered in full during the consultation period of the Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan and responded to in the final draft. And a range of ministers will continue working closely on this, as it does require cross-portfolio working and as well as cross-sector working.
Mercedes Viaba.
I thank the Minister for that response. The Minister will be aware that a key demand from offshore workers in the Our Power report is for the Scottish Government to create an offshore training passport that aligns standards across the energy industry. That passport has already been delayed by the Government, and just today the General Secretary of the STUC warns the Government to get a grip of the transition. So can the Minister reassure offshore workers and their trade unions that the energy skills passport will align offshore basic safety, sea survival and firefighting standards? I am looking for a cast iron guarantee from the Government on this point. Will these standards be aligned, yes or no?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Mercedes Alba for bringing up the offshore skills passport, because I want to say that this has not been delayed by government. This is an industry-led body that is taking the energy skills passport forward. What the government's place in that is helping fund it. We've awarded £5 million from the Just Transition Fund to Apeeto, who are leading on that, yep, for a digital energy skills passport. And a key milestone in that was reached with the development of a prototype, which I've seen. Mercedes Viaba will know that in addition to the report that she cites, I did my own report on this, and it very much came out loud and clear that anything to do with an energy skills passport, the industry and sectors have to be at the heart of that. And I'm actually meeting with Apeeto next week to just see what their progress is on that.
And supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. The Energy Transition Report yesterday highlighted how damaging to a just energy transition this government's demonising of the North Sea oil and gas industry is, epitomised by Minister Patrick Harvey saying that only the hard right support new oil and gas. So does the Minister recognise that report's findings? Will she amend the energy strategy to stop the damage it's doing to our industry? And will she join us in supporting domestic oil and gas exploration and production?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Liam Kerr for that. I am actually smiling as he delivers that, because he knows full well that I have one foot very much in every part of the energy mix. And my interests in actually keeping all the energy mix vibrant and working and employing people until we transition is very much something that I, yep, take a priority in. He refers to the energy strategy. That, of course, has closed now. The consultation on that is closed. It is going to be reporting in the coming months. I am actively involved with my Cabinet Secretary in looking at that, and with other Cabinet Secretaries as well, and how we can actually give confidence to all energy sectors to know that the Scottish Government supports them and their workers fully.
Yep.
Question number 5, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to expand community-owned energy.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We want to realise as many opportunities as possible for community energy and lasting benefits for communities from the transition to net zero. Scotland has made good progress against its 2 GW community and local energy target, and we continue to invest in CARES, our Community and Renewable Energy Scheme, which has provided over £60 million in funding to date for communities and supported shared ownership opportunities. We've recently commissioned research to explore how we maximise the contribution of community energy to a just transition, and this will involve future policy development and the support provided through CARES.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. There is a target in the Government's draft energy strategy of the 2 GW of community energy the Minister mentioned by 2030, but what is missing is that clear route map and actions to deliver on that target. The Scottish Cooperative Party have set out 11 recommendations to double community energy, from creating a new ring-fenced Scottish National Investment Bank fund to including quotas for community energy when it comes to local authorities' bulk buying energy. But what new measures do the Government plan, and will the Minister give careful consideration to the Cooperative Party's proposals in the Government's final energy strategy?
Minister.
I thank Colin Smith for that supplementary question. And he almost could have been a fly in the wall in the meeting that the Cabinet Secretary and I have just been with the Onshore Wind Strategic Leadership Group, because this very much came up as an area of discussion in how we can actually be providing, through CARES, more particularly legal and financial support to communities, and building on the learning from other communities that have involved themselves in community energy projects to get more communities invested in this. I think it's one of the ways in which we have to share learning, because communities are obviously doing this on a voluntary basis, and we need to give them as much support as possible. So very much this is a live discussion. It's a discussion that's probably still going on. We had to leave that meeting to come and answer questions here today, but our partners in that group will be discussing that as well, and we'll be reporting back on their recommendations.
And supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recently, the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly Committee C, which is the Energy Committee, I'm part of that, visited Penpunt Micro Hydro Scheme as part of our current energy inquiry. This scheme provides community energy through to the local area and is a great example of how community-owned energy works. So would the Minister agree that we need to see more schemes like this Penpunt Micro Hydro Scheme rolled out, and will she agree to visit Penpunt to meet with the Development Trust who secured the project?
Minister.
Thank you, Emma Harper, very much for that, and particularly the last part of her comments there about inviting me to visit, because I was going to say before she said that I would actually like to visit that project as well, because I think I come back to what I said in response to Colin Smith, that it's about learning from other communities that have been through this process and how we can actually build on the support that's given and make it streamlined, make it better, make it more supportive for communities that are yet to make that investment.
Question number 6, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting public bodies to implement Fair Work principles.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Public bodies and their spending power are key to making Scotland a leading Fair Work nation. We have developed Fair Work First guidance to all employers. This includes specific advice for public bodies. We have engaged extensively with them on removing barriers for racialised minorities following the Scottish Parliament Equalities and Human Rights Committee's 2020 report into race equality, employment and skills. And we recognise the important dual role public bodies play as employers and stewards of public funds. So working with Scottish Enterprise, we have developed an online support tool for employers to benchmark Fair Work practices and received tailored advice and resources.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. And colleges are public sector organisations and are expected to abide by the principles of Fair Work too. The City of Glasgow College, of course, is undertaking a series of compulsory redundancies, and they're doing so in the absence of any guidance on good higher education governance. The website said for weeks now that the publication is imminent. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm when that will be?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would hope that would come forward in due course. But, of course, for Labour to be taken seriously with regard to Fair Work, you know, they need to have some consistency. Because while Pam Duncan-Glancy is quite rightly standing up for employers at Glasgow College, at Westminster this week, we had the spectacle of 30, more than 30 Labour Party members abstaining from the anti-strike legislation that came forward on Monday. So no wonder, even on workers' rights, nobody knows where Labour stands when Sir Keir Starmer couldn't even be there to vote on that legislation, which included an amendment that would have seen Scotland exempted from that legislation.
And supplementary, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are interesting developments in the Fair Work space happening around the world. Mechanisms to break contracts and withdraw funding if poor labour conditions, data breaches or environmental offences are identified. Germany's Supply Chain Due Diligence Act that holds companies legally responsible for human rights abuses in their supply chain and so on. And the Cabinet Secretary will know well my support for tight pay ratios to close inequality gaps. Within devolved powers, what more can we do to ensure public money does not go to those with very wide pay ratios and those who don't pay sick pay or holiday pay for hourly contracted staff?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Maggie Chapman for that question. With employment law reserved, there are limits on the actions that we can take. However, we are committed to using all the levers available to drive Fair Work across Scotland. We already apply Fair Work First criteria to effect the positive change we want to see through public sector funding. We committed in the Bute House Agreement and NSET to developing our approach to conditionality within the constraints of devolved competence. And this will be a key focus for the next phase when the real living wage and effective worker voice conditionality in grants is fully rolled out after July. Public sector funding should lever in wider benefits, including the promotion of Fair Work, to support a sustainable and successful wellbeing economy over the long term.
And question number 7 has been withdrawn, and therefore I call question number 8, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent assessment is made of the impact of Brexit on Scottish businesses.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish businesses continue to be held back by the UK Government's disastrous Brexit policy. The latest Business Insights and Conditions survey shows that the Scottish businesses facing challenges with exporting in April, 44% blame Brexit directly. Red tape, bureaucracy, uncertainty have become the hallmarks of Brexit, with the UK experiencing the worst exports recovery in the G7. What's more, Brexit has also contributed to labour shortages and recruitment challenges in key sectors such as healthcare, transport and hospitality. Study after study finds Brexit is bad for trade, bad for productivity, bad for the cost of living and bad for business.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. Brexit is failing businesses and damaging our economy. Even the old Brexit party leader, Nigel Farage, says it's failed. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concerns that leaders of the new Brexit party, Keir Starmer and Anna Sarwar, don't even have the courage or vision to abandon Brexit? Given that 70% of Scots think Brexit is a disaster, they don't even need to lead. They should just follow and reverse Labour support for it.
Cabinet Secretary.
Either contender for the leader of the next Westminster government in Keir Starmer or Rishi Sunak, or their Scottish counterparts in Anna Sarwar or Douglas Ross, are willing to admit the extent of the Brexit disaster. But while Labour and the Conservatives tried to sweep this mess under the rug, violating the will of the people of Scotland, this government understands that the only way to repair the damage is to change course, rejoin the EU, and if the UK government do it, whichever stripe comes next, then an independent Scotland will.
And supplementary, Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Border effects reduce trade by as much as a third. That's what a 2017 meta-analysis conducted by University of Michigan concluded. Indeed, we may be seeing empirical evidence from Brexit, which we didn't support. So has the Scottish Government asked the Chief Economist to form a view on the impact of border effects? And how much of Scotland's 60% of outward trade to that goes to the rest of the UK, worth over £50 billion, would we lose if a border was imposed between Scotland and the rest of the UK?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm looking forward to meeting Daniel Johnson in the coming weeks, as I've offered to all front-bench spokespeople across the Chamber, so that I can share with him the economy prospectus paper, which has many of the answers to those questions within them. Because, of course, Mr Johnson...
excuse me, could we listen to the Minister's response? Thank you.
Mr Johnson can see within the report the plans that we have for cross-border trade, which, of course, are being hampered right now because of Brexit, because of the barriers that have been put up by the UK government. We're looking to tear down 27 barriers to trade with the rest of the EU, and the only independents can deliver that.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
The Minister really can't have it both ways. Breaking up is bad. Breaking up the United Kingdom would be bad, just like breaking up the European Union would be bad. Why can't the Minister get that? He's talking nonsense.
Cabinet Secretary.
No, there are huge opportunities that come from independence. There are huge opportunities. I've spoken about the 27 barriers to trade that are currently in place because of Brexit. Of course there would be challenges in terms of cross-border trade with the rest of the UK. But the opportunity that we have with the market that there is within the European Union that is currently being held back, that businesses have already cited, are showing 44% of Brexit businesses are citing Brexit as the reason behind that. We want to reverse that. The only way we know Labour and the Tories are on the same page on this regards Brexit and our relationship with the European Union, only independence delivers us the reversal of Brexit and an independent Scotland rejoining the European Union.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes portfolio questions on wellbeing, economy, fair work and energy. And there will be a very short pause to allow front bench teams to change position before we move to the next portfolio questions. Thank you.
Okay, the next portfolio is finance and parliamentary business. As ever, if a member wishes to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. There is quite a bit of interest in supplementaries, so again, the plea of brevity in questions and in responses. And I call question number one, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the STUC's proposals for a local wealth tax.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Presiding Officer, we welcome the STUC's report and acknowledge its important contribution to the debate on tax policy. We believe in a fair and progressive approach to taxation where those most able to afford it contribute more to sustaining public services. And we're also committed to a fair and fiscally sustainable form of local taxation.
Ariane Burgess.
In Buckie, Speyside, Elgin and Forres, half of the land available for housing is owned by just 5 landowners. Does the Minister agree with me that the land and wealth taxes highlighted in the report could be a useful tool for tackling unequal land ownership, increasing the number of homes in rural areas and capturing for public benefit a share of the increase in land value that occurs when development is supported through the planning system?
Minister.
The Scottish Government recognises that tax could be an important mechanism in addressing land ownership patterns and influencing the market. We are currently reviewing the evidence provided in response to our recent consultation on the Land Reform Bill and will assess this separately as part of our wider approach to tax policy. This will include consideration of representations from stakeholders for a land value tax. However, I would note that the Scottish Government's ability to implement such a tax is constrained by the devolution settlement and that the Scottish Land Commission, in their advice to the Scottish Government, did not propose a single land value tax.
Supplementary, Liz Smith.
Thank you. Can I ask the Minister what plans the Scottish Government is putting in place to carry out a review of the efficacy of the whole tax system in Scotland, given the warnings that are set out by the Scottish Fiscal Commission in its recent sustainability report?
Minister.
We continually keep our policies on taxation under review. We take decisions as part, of course, of the annual budget process. Indeed, we are committed through our new deal with local government to further collaboration engagement with local government on local taxation, and the Deputy First Minister will be carrying out further engagement on tax over the summer months, details of which will be provided in due course.
Question number two, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will propose scheduling parliamentary time to debate the potential role of artificial intelligence in the scrutiny of legislation.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the member for the question. I'm happy to be able to say to Mr Whitfield that a debate on artificial intelligence is scheduled for Thursday the 1st of June. This will provide him with an opportunity to contribute his views on the issue. Any use of AI would have to ensure that all are aware, all the public politicians and stakeholders agree and are aware of the AI use. And more importantly, Presiding Officer, we don't find ourselves all replaced in some kind of dystopian future. All joking aside, I heard that note from Mr. as well. All joking aside, it's important to note that the Scottish Parliament scrutinises all legislation.
Minister, I encourage you to ignore the sedentary interventions from Mr. Johnson. Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for that response, and I have now discovered the power of submitting a question to portfolio to get a debate. But the question of AI is very important. The First Minister met with the conveners group only earlier today and talked about being very open to committees asking about better scrutiny of legislation. So can I ask what the Scottish Government has done to engage with AI in the creation of legislation, in reaching out to people that legislation may affect, and indeed to the drafting of that legislation?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank Mr. Whitfield for his supplementary. The Government considers it important to ensure that scrutiny remains sufficiently flexible to enable the Parliament to hold Government to account in an efficient and effective manner. As I said previously, the public and partners would need to be agreeable and be not surprised of any kind of future use of AI in any shape or form. And the technology would have to be in such a place where we could actually be pretty consistent and be able to trust said technology to deliver for us. However, I recognise that parliamentary scrutiny should evolve as technology develops, and I therefore will be interested to hear more about how AI might play a part in that in due course.
Good question. Three, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the latest data reportedly showing that a majority of Scottish taxpayers now pay higher income tax than those elsewhere in the United Kingdom.
Cabinet Secretary.
According to the Scottish Fiscal Commission's December forecast, 52% of Scottish taxpayers will pay slightly less income tax in 2023-24 than if they lived elsewhere in the UK for the sixth consecutive year. The Commission will publish updated forecasts incorporating the latest economic data alongside the medium-term financial strategy tomorrow. We have always prioritised a fair and progressive approach to taxation, one that balances the need to raise revenue with the impact on households and the economy. For income tax, this has seen additional revenue raised for the Scottish budget, with lower earners protected from higher taxes.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response, but I fear the data she's quoting from the Fiscal Commission is now out of date, given that the most recent data shows that anyone earning over £27,850, now the majority of Scots are paying more tax than those elsewhere in the UK. Now, I would commend to her the very interesting article in the Herald newspaper this morning by her former ministerial colleague, Ivan McKee, now, of course, a member of the government in waiting on the back benches, in which he argues for the Scottish Government to make Scotland a more attractive place for workers to come from other parts of the United Kingdom, something I think we would all agree with. And yet we all hear from the business community, and particularly those in sectors like finance, the difficulties they have in encouraging people to come here because of differential tax rates. So how can we attract more people to come and work here when they feel they're being punished with higher taxes to make up for SNP waste and financial mismanagement?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, let me say, of course, each year we do publish the distributional analysis of our income tax policy to transparently set out the impacts, and that's all there for everyone to see. And, of course, the median wage for 23-24 that is used in this analysis derives, of course, from the independent forecasts from the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And what is clear from the IFS analysis is that the households with children in approximately the bottom third of the income distribution in Scotland will gain around £1,200 per year as a result of our tax and social security policy. At the end of the day, this is all about choices. Now, had we followed the choices of Murdo Fraser, who of course backed Liz Truss and emulated the same tax-cutting policies, then he knows, of course, we would have had hundreds of millions of pounds less available for public spending. And on his final point, Scotland continues to see consistent positive net inward migration from the rest of the UK. Those are the facts, which rather stands in contrast to the assertion that Murdo Fraser made earlier on. So we will continue to make sure that we balance the needs of households with the needs of public services, and we'll continue to do that. And through the summer, I will engage with people from a range of organisations in order to ensure that we listen to those views as we go towards setting the tax policy for next year's budget. And of course, happy to engage with any suggestions from Murdo Fraser or his colleagues, but the budget has to balance. And of course, as he knows, many of his colleagues come here asking for more money. So in any tax policies put forward by the Tories, that has to balance with the availability of resources for public spending.
I'm going to need a bit more brevity in responses as well as the questions. A brief supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would agree with me that it appears for the Conservatives that the ideal world would be no tax, no schools, no hospitals and no roads. And if we want all of these things, then we do need tax, and tax is inherently a good thing.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, absolutely, it's the case that the investment in public services resulting from our tax policy makes a vital contribution towards making Scotland a great place to live, work and indeed do business. And of course, we have access to a wide range of social security payments and public services that go significantly beyond what is provided in other parts of the UK, including free higher education, free prescriptions or indeed our flagship Scottish child payment. And of course, the Scottish Fiscal Commission have estimated that our income tax policy will raise £1 billion of additional revenue in 2023-24. If the Tories want to put that at risk, they need to tell us what will be cut with a different tax approach.
Question 4, Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact it anticipates that its taxation policy, including in relation to businesses, will have on the strength of the economy.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The strong economy is vital to ensuring the benefits of our tax policy choices are fully realised, and that is why we launched our National Strategy for Economic Transformation in March 2022 to create a greener, fairer and more inclusive wellbeing economy. Alongside this, our New Deal for Scottish Business will provide an opportunity to discuss how tax policy can support businesses, our communities and grow the Scottish economy. We will continue to prioritise a fair and progressive approach to our tax policy and carefully consider the impacts of our policies on taxpayers, households and businesses.
Pam Gosell.
Thank the Minister for that response. Scottish businesses face a real struggle in Scotland. Despite the businesses' rates re-evaluation, Scottish retail, hospitality and leisure businesses still face tax bills thousands of pounds higher than their English counterparts. And that's because the SNP refused to provide the same discount that is available down south. Does the Minister accept that the lack of business rates makes it harder to do business in Scotland than elsewhere in the United Kingdom, especially when the base poundage rate is only 0.1 pence lower than in England?
Minister.
Well, I thank the member for highlighting the basic property rate, which is indeed lower, and it did respond to what was the number one ask of business organisations ahead of the budget, which was a freeze on the poundage. Decisions around non-domestic rates and indeed non-domestic rates relief are of course taken in the round at budget time and are set against the context of the priorities that we undertake to deliver on through the budget. I would note that around half of RHL properties pay no rates because they fall below the threshold for the small business bonus scheme, the most generous of its type within the United Kingdom. What I would say to the member, and it follows on from questions that were raised earlier, if the Conservatives wish to see at future budgets further relief provided for a particular sector, then I would be keen to hear where they choose to obtain that funding from. Where would be the corresponding budget reduction? Because we commit all of our consequentials in total, in sum, towards the priorities that we set out at the budget. So if members wish to see tax cuts, then that would cost money. If they wish to see more money for local government, that would cost money. And if they wish to see further relief for non-domestic rates, that would cost money. To govern is to choose, and that is nowhere more apparent than when we set budgets. So if the Conservative government, it's this Conservative government in the United Kingdom, are entitled to set their policies, we are entitled to set our policies in this Parliament, and if the Conservatives as an opposition party here want to engage constructively, I'm more than happy to do so. But they can't just ask for spend, they have to identify what the corresponding reduction would be.
Again, we need greater brevity in particularly the responses at the moment. I've got two supplementaries that, if they are brief, I'll get them both in. Bill Kidd, firstly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're aware of the significant impacts of Tory tax policy on the economy, especially following the disastrous mini-budget last October. What assessment has the Scottish Government made of the impact of these decisions on Scotland's economy? And can we agree that business and our economy more generally would be better served with full fiscal powers lying with this Parliament?
Minister.
Persistent high inflation and the cost of living crisis are causing unprecedented drops in living standards. Brexit and fiscal instability brought on by UK government decisions have made these problems worse. Now, I recognise entirely that we are operating within broad global economic challenges, but Brexit, a policy choice, a hard Brexit, a clear policy choice by the UK government, now supported by the Labour Party, is inflicting untold damage on our economy. It is compounding impacts that all countries are facing, and it is ultimately a consequence of reckless decision-making by the UK government. And if we want to find ourselves in a position where we are no longer subject to governments that we did not vote for taking decisions against our interests, then I'm afraid the only means to achieve that is through Scotland becoming an independent country.
I'm Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. A change that would benefit our struggling high streets would be to bring down the higher rate of non-domestic rates in line with England. So when will we see this change?
Minister.
We have taken action following the Barclay Review to move towards that. We introduced the intermediate property relief a number of years ago, which significantly reduced the number of businesses subject to the higher property relief. We have increased the threshold from £95,000 to £100,000 most recently, and we are committed to, as per our manifesto commitment, to achieve that parity over the course of this parliamentary term.
Question 5, Sarah Boyer.
Ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported concerns of Edinburgh City Council that it could still be 2 years away from having the powers to implement a transient visitor levy.
Minister Tom Arthur.
As part of the Government's priorities for Scotland announced by the First Minister on 18 April, we are committed to delivering, subject to Parliament's agreement, legislation giving councils the power to apply visitor levy if they choose to do so. Once any bill is introduced, the timetable for its consideration is, of course, a matter for Parliament.
Sarah Boyer.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? I've been calling for a levy for years now, and it is frustrating to see how long it's taking to get this action from the Scottish Government. The Minister will be aware that many cities in Europe successfully operate visitor levies, and the City of Edinburgh Council has very well developed plans to implement a levy, and they estimate that approximately £15 million a year could be raised to help fund vital local services. So will the Minister meet with me in Edinburgh City Council to discuss the levy in detail and make sure that Edinburgh, and indeed other areas who want to in Scotland, can implement these measures as soon as they have the power to do so?
Minister.
I'd be delighted to.
Maybe a couple of supplementaries. First, Ben McPherson.
I am also supportive of a local visitor levy in Edinburgh, as are many organisations, including from the business community. But good implementation and development is important. So does the Minister agree with me that it is vital to take the appropriate and necessary time to take a bill through Parliament and then give relevant councils who wish to utilise that power and stakeholders adequate time to prepare and effectively administer and collect a levy?
Minister.
Absolutely. I agree entirely with Mr McPherson, and I would want to pay tribute to Ben McPherson for the work that he undertook as Public Finance Minister prior to the pandemic and his engagement with local authorities on this particular measure. Once the bill is introduced to Parliament, I, of course, will be delighted to engage with all members and, indeed, local authorities in doing so. And, of course, rigorous parliamentary scrutiny will be important to ensure the legislation that is ultimately put before Parliament for a final vote is as robust as it can and should be.
Thank you. I'm going to call Miles Briggs, but with a reminder that members need to be in the starter portfolio questions. They can sometimes finish early, but it's rule on business. But Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I ask, does the Minister believe that there may be a link between Edinburgh City Council being the only council which is looking to take forward tourist tax and the fact that Edinburgh City Council receives the lowest level of funding per head of population from the government?
Minister.
I would not want to presume to speak on behalf of Edinburgh City Council, but I would recognise that Edinburgh City is not just a premier tourist destination for Scotland and indeed the UK, but is a premier tourist destination for the world, and that is something we should all be proud of.
Question number six, Carol Mochen.
To ask the Scottish Government how much it has allocated in its budget 2023-24 for the rollout of free school meals to all primary school pupils.
Cabinet Secretary.
The 23-24 budget has made provision for £185.8 million to be allocated to local authorities for free school meals. This funding supports our universal free school meal offer for all pupils in primaries 1 to 5, as well as meals for eligible pupils from P6 to S6. It will also support the next phase of our expansion programme, which will see free school meals being made available to all pupils in primaries 6 and 7 in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment.
Carol Mochen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. When I asked the then Cabinet Secretary for Education in March, she recognised, and I quote, that a number of local authorities are facing challenges in planning for that substantial expansion of free school meals. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what direct support is going where in the provision to councils to overcome such challenges? And has she given consideration to calls by organisations such as Aberlour, which ask government to increase the eligibility threshold beyond the already promised extension to P6 and P7 in order to support low-income families?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Carol Mochen rightly points to some of the complexities around planning for the substantial expansion of free school meals, particularly around the kitchen and dining facilities required to support this. And of course, it's not a universal picture, so some schools have more challenges than others. So a lot of work has been undertaken to understand that and to make sure the resources are going to the places that they need to go to. So I would hope Carol Mochen will agree that that's a sensible set of arrangements. In regard to the expansion, I think it is right that the expansion is focused on all pupils in primary 6 and 7 in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment. I understand the position of Aberlour, but we have to do this in a way that is deliverable, but also that is affordable. And I think that is the best place to start as we continue with our commitment to expand free school meals to all primary 6 and 7, and of course we are still committed to the pilot in secondary schools as well.
And brief supplementary, Monica Lennon.
Thank you very much. Because most secondary schools use a cashless payment system, it's actually difficult for school meal debt to accrue in those settings. So what steps is the government taking to assess the true level of hidden hunger in secondary schools and to assess the implementation of school meal debt management guidance that was rolled out earlier this year?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we would rely on local authorities to make sure that they are feeding back any issues in relation to the guidance, and we will continue to work with local authorities to see if any improvements can be made. They obviously have the flexibility around the dealing with the debt in individual cases, and we would encourage them to do so. But ultimately, it will be for local authorities to advise us if there are any issues particularly pertaining to the guidance.
Question 7, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on implementation of the Planning Scotland Act 2019.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. We've recently implemented substantial elements of the 2019 Planning Act to strengthen Scotland's plan-led planning system. That's included adoption on the 13th of February of the National Planning Framework 4. And just last week, regulations came into force which implemented the new approach to planning authorities, production of stronger, evidence-based and place-focused local development plans to shape future developments across Scotland. We're now turning our attention to implementation of the remaining aspects of the Act, including forthcoming appointment of a new National Planning Improvement Champion.
Ruth Maguire.
I thank the Minister for that answer. On Monday, which was incidentally UN Biodiversity Day, I visited Ardeer Peninsula with the Community Council and Friends of Ardeer. The Special Development Order, which I amended the Planning Bill to revoke a number of years ago, remains in place, and development and commercial activity on the peninsula are not subject to the usual planning protections. A sand dune system has been destroyed for commercial gain. It's a devastating loss of important ecological habitat. I understand the complexity of the matter of revocation and appreciate competing rights and interests of community, commerce and public bodies. However, inaction is not an option. Will the Minister meet with me with a view to resolving the matter sooner rather than later?
Minister.
I'm aware of the specific and complex circumstances at Ardeer and the implications for the planning of the area, particularly resulting from the Special Development Order in force here. And I'm also aware that Ms Maguire has written to me on this. She won't yet have received my response, but I will be happy to meet with Ms Maguire to discuss these matters in detail.
Thank you. And brief supplementary, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you. Across the North East, communities are struggling with planning issues. Torrey in Aberdeen might be about to lose a biodiverse green space and its last community park to development. In Angus, a crematorium is planned on agricultural land without appropriate transport connections and other amenities to deal with increased capacity and activity. How can the Scottish Government ensure that local authorities are following the MPF4 principles and guidance and doing all they can to protect communities' well-being and safeguarding nature?
Minister.
Thank you. Members will appreciate that I can't comment on any individual development proposals to be considered through the planning system. However, following its adoption in February, MPF4 took on a new statutory development plan status alongside local development plans. So that means that all decision makers are required under the Planning Act to determine applications in accordance with the development plan, including MPF4, unless there are material planning considerations that justify a departure from the plan. We are, of course, monitoring the impact of MPF4 and its policies as part of a programme of work to support its delivery.
Question 8, Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with the Chancellor of the Exchequer and what was discussed.
Cabinet Secretary.
The most recent meeting between the Scottish Government and the Chancellor of the Exchequer was at a meeting of the Prime Minister and the heads of the devolved governments on the 10th of November 2022, when the economic outlook and impact of rising inflation were discussed. I had an introductory meeting with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury on the 2nd of May and will meet with him again at the upcoming Finance Interministerial Standing Committee meeting on the 22nd of June. I would welcome a meeting with the Chancellor himself to discuss the economic challenges facing Scotland and the constraints placed upon the Scottish Government's finances. I will also encourage the UK Government to do more to provide support to people and businesses during this difficult economic period.
Annabel Ewing.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer, and given in particular the ongoing negative impacts of high inflation on Scotland's fixed budget, of course, the need, I would say, for fiscal flexibility, such as normal borrowing powers, is ever more pressing to manage risk and to support economic recovery. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore advise whether the UK Government is, in fact, on Scotland's side here?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, Annabel Ewing is quite right to mention the impact of inflation, which, of course, is being felt very much in the budget, as a block grant at the time that the budget was set was 4.8% lower in real terms than it was in 2021-22. And that the fixed nature of the budget means that we have to redirect money from other priorities to pay for things like increased public sector pay deals. Now, I've made it clear to the UK Government the need for greater flexibility and borrowing powers to enable us to manage risks and support economic recovery. We've consistently made the case for additional funding in my recent meeting with the CST. I stressed the need for further clarity on what consequentials we can expect, for example, from NHS pay in England. And whilst the UK Government has rejected our previous calls for greater fiscal flexibility, we remain in constructive discussion discussions on the wider fiscal framework review.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change. Thank you.